Angelica, an Ecuadorian sister, shares the revelation she received from God of heaven and hell, after a time of prayer and fasting.
I will begin testifying. Honestly, I am tired. Some people look at me as if I'm a very spiritual person, but I am not. But people think that I am so spiritual person. I am actually a person who makes many mistakes. I want you to realize something. I never told Lord to have these experiences. God did this to me from His tender mercy. Sometimes I weep, you know why? Because it is not easy. Truly serving God faithfully is very beautiful, but you must be brave. In my last experience, asking for forgiveness was something very beautiful. We cried and embraced while I asked for forgiveness. After asking for forgiveness, the only thing that I remember is that they said the doctors had arrived. Approximately 12:30 p.m. at night, I believe that's what time my experience began. The ministers and brethren were all in intercessory prayer while I had this experience.
Angelica will now testify her experience. This is when angels took her to a heavenly viewpoint and showed her the current condition of the church.
From a heavenly viewpoint, an angel said,
"Look, you are seeing the earth. Look at the churches and congregations of the earth. This church has 20,000 members. There is another church with 10,000 members. This other church has 1,000. But there are very few people in these churches that are actually the true church. Are you seeing?"
"Yes," I answered. The angel said,
"I must tell you what my father wants me to tell you."
The Archangel Michael was the one speaking to me. Michael said,
"Look at the earth. The churches are filled with sin. There is very much sin in the churches. Many of the people are spiritually dead."
I was shown that 80% of the evangelical Christian church on earth will be left behind. My God, they will be left behind because they are cold. Because they don't seek God's presence. Because of their sin. Because they are discouraged. Only 20% will be caught up to be with Jesus. This is only for true Christians. This why His word says, "Many are called, but few are chosen," in Matthew 22. We were all called. But we not only must be called, we must also be chosen. Let me explain what takes place inside many of the churches. There is very much religion. There is no loyalty to the Word of God. Inside church, brothers and sisters happily praise the Lord. They rejoice, they dance, and they speak in tongues. But when they get home, they are completely different. They act like the devil himself. This is what takes place. People go home and speak things that hurt God's heart. At home you don't pray, read God's word or seek His presence. God does not want any of us to be left behind. It hurts me that 80% of church congregants are not ready for the Lord's return. Do you know why? Because few of the churches truly demonstrate the true love of Jesus. There were angels around when Jesus spoke to me. The angels were silent. The Lord said,
"Daughter, my heart breaks to see how many people are discouraged, to see how many people have backslid. Tell my people to return to ancient paths, to the first love."
All of us have been seeking God diligently during this 21-day fast. After this, we can't look back at the past. We must press forward. The Lord promised us in His word, He will be with us. Don't worry about the trials to come in the future. You can't imagine the trials I have endured. Actually, all of us endure together. Although I don't know your trial, it doesn't really matter. We must press forward because only the courageous will enter in His presence. When you return to your congregations, you must encourage the brethren. We are one family in Christ. You must encourage them to seek God. Tell them to seek God. Reject hypocrisy. Listen to what the Lord told me. He said,
"Do you know which commandment my church has forgotten? Someone think it is love. Others think it's faith. The forgotten commandment within the church is holiness. My word says, 'Be holy for I am holy.'"
This is what the Lord said. We have to be holy inside and outside. We must have a pure heart, a clean heart that is filled with His presence. A heart filled with His love. A heart filled with God. An angel approached me and asked,
"Are you ready?"
"The Lord has sent us for this purpose." I answered, Yes. The Lord had taken away all my fear. I told them, I'm ready. They said,
That's good. We are awaited.
This experience was different than the other two. This time I did not travel to heaven in the same manner as before. This time I instantly entered the kingdom of heaven. When I looked around, I realized I was wearing a beautiful white dress. We began walking. At first, the angels were not speaking to me. The angels were just worshiping the Lord. The angels told me,
Look around, for we have many things to show you.
I began to see some places I had seen in my first experience, such as flowers and a beautiful garden. When we passed a garden, we arrived to a place that was filled with children. These children were about 2 or 3 years old. They danced, played, and sang. As I looked at them, the angels told me,
Look, to such as these is the kingdom of heaven.
Remember, only for those who open their hearts. Many of these children were killed. Many of them were aborted. Their mothers took their lives. I continued to look at the children as they worshiped the Lord. They played on what appeared to me to be a swing set. When I began to walk toward them, they approached me. Michael was the angel standing closest to me. He said, Today the Lord gives you a great love for children. Previously, I liked children, but sometimes I hated their behavior. I didn't like to hear them cry, whine or talk too much. I just liked them to sit still. Michael said,
God gives you a new love for children. When you return to earth, you will be like honey to them. They will look for you and you will be a blessing to them. Do you know why God places this love in your heart for children? God wants you to win their souls. There are many children in hell. You must speak to their parents so they will know.
Many children in this generation are rebellious. They do not obey their parents. Many children may look small in stature, but their mentality will often surpass of grown adults. Do you know why this is? Nowadays, children are being deceived by Satan through the television. Most of the shows they watch do not edify in any way. Parents don't realize it, but there are many kids that watch pornographic videos. The cartoons that come on TV are not educational, they are evil. Children are influenced by these shows and they become rebellious. They continually disobey their parents. For these reasons, children end up in hell. The kingdom of heaven belongs to children, but only to those children who have Jesus in their hearts. In heaven, the children were playing, laughing, and worshiping the Lord. I had great joy to see their happiness. When the angel told me that many of them had been aborted, it really hurt my heart. You know what is sad? Many women have had abortions. Young and old, married and single. These women did not want their children. Sometimes the fathers would accompany them to the clinic. Those babies go to the presence of God, but the men and women of the earth become murderers. The Word of God says that no murderer shall enter the kingdom of heaven. It hurt my heart to know how many women have taken the lives of their own children. How many men and women have committed this great sin. If you have done this, repent today. You know why? If you do not repent and ask God for forgiveness, this is what will take place on your day of judgment. Your children will come as a witness against you and say, You were my mother, you were my father, and you took my life. Can you imagine the pain you will feel? They love you, they forgive you, but if you do not repent of that sin, you will go to hell for eternity. Inside the church, this sin has been committed. Me and the angels with me left that place and began heading towards where Jesus was. I was very happy. When I approached the Lord, He took me by the hand. When He touched my hand, I felt as if I was a newborn baby being touched by a loving father. As Jesus held my hand, we began to descend towards a very dark place. I could see there were very large flames of fire. Jesus told me,
We are going towards the heart of hell.
To the heart of hell? Hell has a heart? I said.
Yes, my daughter, hell has a heart. I will show what is inside of it. There are many pastors, evangelists, prophets, and apostles in this place. These men once served me, but now they are in this location.
I began to cry. I said, No more, Lord, I don't want to see this anymore. I felt I had already seen enough. We continued walking. We were walking through as a dark alley. We walked up to some bars, like a gate, the gate opened and we entered. When we entered, I heard the voice of a man crying out. He was yelling, he said,
"Father, get me out of here. I can't stand being here any longer."
I asked the Lord, "Who was that?" "He must have known you on earth because you said you would show me people who once served you. I don't understand why he refers to you as Father, while he is in hell." The Lord told me,
"He was a pastor."
The man stood there pretending to be holding a Bible. The man in hell was preaching,
"Repent, repent, brethren, Church of Christ, you must repent."
I asked, "Why is he preaching here, Lord?" The Lord said,
"What people did on the earth, they continue to do in this place."
When I saw this, I began to cry. I asked, "Why is he here? If he was a pastor, why is he in this place?" Jesus said,
"Daughter, it is due to this."
I was shown his life on earth as a screen appeared before me.
On earth, he was a respecter of persons. He showed partiality and favoritism to people of different classes in my holy place. Showing partiality is a sin. He preached many times from the pulpit showing partiality. Showing partiality towards people of wealth, towards people who were upper class, those people had money, but they did not fear my word. He showed partiality to those people who did not have godly fear in their hearts.
I cried and said, "Lord, I did not know that showing partiality was a sin." He said,
"Yes, daughter, many people wanted to serve me and be part of his church, but he didn't allow them to participate. This pastor never repented from showing partiality. Because of this sin, many people never came to me. This is why he is in this place. Even here, in hell, he preaches my word with partiality."
In hell, this man would approach souls and say,
"Take this, I share my Bible with you, preach."
He looked at Jesus and said,
"Father, I can't stand being here any longer. Take me out of this place. I don't want to sin anymore. Give me another chance."
The Lord answered him,
"There is no more opportunity for you, and you are too late."
There are congregations everywhere that practice partiality and favoritism. This is a sin. Every soul has an equal calling for salvation. Although it seems insignificant, partiality is a great sin. The Lord told me to tell people,
"Don't practice partiality, it is a sin."
I said, "All right, Lord, I want to go with the angels now. By the way, I want to mention something else. I never saw the Lord's face. I would always look at his garments or his hands, but I could never see his face. Every time I attempted to see his face, I felt as if I would go blind. On many occasions I would see tears come down his garments. His sandals were gold. When tears would land on his sandals, crystals would form. Many times Jesus would begin to weep. He is weeping like a child. He would say,
'Daughter, my heart is in pain.'"
Jesus has a heart. His heart breaks when he sees us in sin. God doesn't want us to sin. God desires to set us free from the bondage of sin. God's will for us to walk in the Spirit and not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. He desires for us to do great things for his kingdom. The Lord told me,
"I will show you another sin that takes place in the altars at churches. It is regard music."
The Lord showed me people's playing and listening to rock music, rap music, reggae music, in the altar at churches. This displeases the Lord. The Word of God says, he wants us to worship him in spirit and in truth. He does not say he seeks those who will rap for him in spirit and in truth. In hell, we moved to another location. Here I saw a young man who was singing. He was singing Christian rap or reggae style music. He was singing a song that I know, another musician sings, but I won't mention that musician's name. He was singing Christian rap or reggae style music. I asked the Lord, "Why is he here? Lord, I really want to know, why is he here? Why is he singing?" At this time I was remembering how many musicians are in hell. Selena, Michael Jackson, and many other musicians are burning in hell. I asked, "Lord, did he sing in church?"
"Yes, daughter, he sang at church."
The Lord did not say anything else after that statement. The Lord allowed me to approach the young man, but the Lord was holding my hand. So I began to speak to this young man. He said,
My name is Mark. I am in this place because I did not worship the Lord. I sang rap-style music instead. I would sing these songs at church, but I did not like to pray. I had no prayer life. I did not like to seek God's presence. My purpose in singing these songs was to attract young people to church. I wanted gang members to come to God. I did not realize it is God who must draw them. It is He alone that deals with our hearts.
I asked, "How long have you been in this place?" He said,
4 years.
I asked, "Is there any other reason why you are here?" He said,
"Yes, I had very much pride. I am also here because of that. Here, the demons torment me continually and laugh at me. They say, worldly music is an instrument we use to bring youth to this place."
Mark was completely bound while he spoke to me, even while he sang. His arms and body were tied with snakes. He would cry and ask me,
"Can you help me?"
I said, "No, Mark, I would if I could, but I can't." He said,
"I know, I will never get out of here. Look at me, I am in torment. When I died, I fell into a tunnel. After I descended from the tunnel, my body exploded as I landed in hell. Worms came out of my body and I have remained in torment until now. I have become disfigured and the flames of hell continue to burn me. I can't stand it anymore. The demons say this is my kingdom and that Satan is my God."
I said, "I understand, but Mark, on the earth you had a chance to repent." He cried and said,
"Tell the young people to worship Jesus. Tell the whole church to worship. God seeks true worshipers."
After Mark had spoken, a flame came between me and Mark. He became engulfed by the flames as soon as I stepped away. While we had been speaking, the flames had only risen to his waist. After this last statement, his torment continued as before. The Lord said,
"Daughter, many people think that with certain music and certain programs they are able to attract the world and reach the gang members and drug addicts. No, it is not men that bring conviction of sin. It is the Holy Spirit that deals with and convinces man of his sins. It is I who touches hearts. It is I who deals with the hearts of man. I alone am able to save man. Men think they are saviors."
This is what the Lord told me. This was so difficult for me. I think that if you are listening to this type of music, you need to stop. This is between you and God though. I fulfill God's will in telling you. I am no longer responsible because I told you what God told me. If you want to accept it, accept it. If you want to reject it, reject it. I fulfill my responsibility. This is something He required of me. If I don't obey Him, hell waits. I don't want to go to that place. I don't want to end up in a place of torment. I have been there 3 times. I know that hell is more real than life on earth. As we left Mark's cell, he began to blaspheme. The Lord told me,
"When we leave this place, tell my church to worship me in spirit and in truth."
We moved onto a different location. At this location, I saw a woman in front of me. The woman said,
"I can't stand this anymore. I can't bear it any longer. Lord, help me."
This woman served God for many years while she was on earth. After this life, you do not get credit for how many years you knew the Lord. We only inherit salvation by serving God with all our hearts and living our lives in His will. This woman knew God's word. She had even preached God's word, but she was in hell for the sin of adultery. This is what made this extremely sad and troubling for me. In hell, she was being tormented by snakes in a similar manner to how prostitutes are tormented. She would tell the evil spirits,
"I'm a pastor's wife, don't touch me. Don't do this to me."
The demons tortured her anyway. The Lord confirmed what she had told me regarding adultery. He said,
"She is here for committing fornication and adultery."
On the earth, she had been a pastor's wife who preached God's word. She had children as well, but this did not keep her from infidelity to her husband. You know what? This sin takes place in many churches. Even many ministers of God's word have committed this sin. This must stop. It has gone on for too long. Resist the devil and he will flee. Put your trust in Jesus. It was so difficult for me to see this. It is sad to know often this takes place. This does not exist in every church, but it does in very many. We moved to another location. I heard a young man yelling,
"Help me, Lord! Help me!"
The young man who was yelling had been an evangelist on the earth. He also committed fornication. He committed this sin a multitude of times. The Word of God wants,
but if they can't control themselves, they should go ahead and marry. It is better to marry than to burn with lust.
If you are burning with lust, get married. It is better to get married and avoid sinning. If you live in sin and die, you will go to hell. This young man fell into fornication and went to hell because of it. He was a preacher of God's word. This teaches us that we must pray without ceasing and be ever vigilant of the traps of the enemy. The enemy is continually on the outlook for how he can attack the ministries of God's word. There are millions of demons ready to tempt preachers. It is very important for the church to intercede for its pastors. Not only local pastors, but pastors all around the world. The ministers of God's word need protection, because they are continually under attack. You know, it's not easy to be a minister. We have so many attacks of the enemy. As I walked away from the young man, flames engulfed him and he continued to be tortured. My heart ached for that young man. I still feel bad for him. I share this with you to realize we must obey God's word. After leaving that location, I went to another place. In this location, a pastor was burning in torment. This man was holding his hand in a manner in which he seemed to be drinking an alcoholic drink. He was acting drunk. I thought, a drunken pastor in hell? He had been a hypocrite in church. This man had pastored a large congregation with a multitude of members. The Lord revealed to me, not only had he been a drunk, he was also a liar and an adulterer. Next to the pastor was a demon that appeared to him like a woman. In hell he continued to be a drunk and an adulterer with a demon who tortured him. The man told me,
"I was a pastor. I preached God's word, but I did not live God's word. I would get drunk and I also cheated on my wife. I never repented of my sinful ways."
This man knew that God's word says that adulterers shall not enter the kingdom of heaven, neither shall drunkards. Many people on earth preach God's word but continue to live in sin. People need to stop sinning and begin to seek God. The pastor told me,
"You must warn people not to come to this place. Please, you must warn the churches to escape the flames of hell."
The Lord showed me a large screen that showed a part of his life. On earth he would preach, while his wife was with him supporting his ministry. He was wealthy and prosperous. But you know what? In hell he no longer had opportunities of salvation. He no longer had the women he had loved on the earth. For all eternity, all he had was eternal torment. I was discouraged when I saw how a pastor could end up in hell. I told the Lord, "I don't want to see anymore, I don't even want to preach anymore." The Lord spoke to me and said,
"Daughter, you must fulfill my will. You must obey. I will show you why."
As we continued on the next cell, a woman was there. The Lord told me several things about her. I knew her name and where she had lived on the earth. This woman had been called into the ministry at the age of 15. At that time she told God,
"Lord, I am not ready to enter the ministry. I am too young. Allow me to finish school and graduate."
After she had finished school, the Lord called her again. She then said,
"I am married. I must focus on taking care of my children. Not now."
The woman went on to raise her children. After the children were raised and began to have family of their own, the woman focused on raising her grandchildren. The Lord told me,
"I continued calling her throughout her entire life, but she disobeyed me and rejected her calling."
The Lord asked me,
"Will you reject my calling?"
I said, "No, Lord, I will not. But Lord, this isn't easy for me." The Lord said,
"I will be with you. It is I who speak through you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I will help you and guide you."
I was crying. I made a promise. I said, "Okay, Lord. Whoever rises against me may rise. You promised me you would be with me, so I will continue no matter what. I don't want to end up here. I want to continue, because I must fulfill God's calling upon my life." This same lady had become older when she had passed away. She went to hell for disobedience. Over 5,000 souls were lost because of her. The demons in hell would tell her, "Look around. Many of these souls are here because of you." The woman in hell would cry. She looked at the Lord and said,
"Lord, forgive me for disobeying my calling. Forgive me for not responding to you."
How many people on earth are in this situation? When the Lord calls you and chooses you, you must obey. The Lord called me when I was just 17 years old. I knew absolutely nothing about the Bible. Since then, the Holy Spirit has been teaching me, little by little. In hell, this woman pleaded with the Lord for forgiveness for rejecting her calling. The Lord said,
"You have no more opportunities of forgiveness."
The Lord tearfully spoke to me. He said,
"Do not refuse me. I have called you and chosen you. You are to be my watchman, so that you may take my word to all nations."
God chose you to hear this message. Many people will not hear it. She has now repented for not having obeyed the voice of God, but it is too late. Now I ask you, what will you do? Will you obey what the Lord is commanding you to do? You have been chosen by God to reach the lost. We must fulfill God's will because He chose us to abide in His perfect will. If we do this, we will be in His presence for all eternity. Don't reject it any longer. Receive it. The Holy Spirit will guide you, not man, God. God Himself will guide you. That woman was continually tormented by demons in hell. They would tell her, "God had spoken to you and called you. You disobeyed the Lord and now you're here for eternity." I cried as I left that woman. I asked the Lord to forgive me for not wanting to preach His word. You know why I wanted to stop preaching? It is because some people accuse me of being a false prophet. After I had this experience, I don't care about their accusations any longer. They could say whatever they want, but I will keep on preaching His word. The Lord told me,
"Do not fear men, but fear me. Don't worry about their opinions, focus on mine."
So why should we worry about men's opinions and not the Lord's? Men cannot grant eternal life. Only Jesus is able to give eternal life. He and He alone have this authority. Worry about His opinion, not man's opinion. Even if people continually criticize you, don't allow that to be a hindrance. Don't allow that to make you quit. May their false accusations and criticism cause you to rise up stronger. When the enemy uses many people to speak evil, God will use this to help you endure and press forward. The trials we face are difficult, but Jesus is with us. Jesus Christ will hold our hand through these trials. He said, "I am with you always, even to the end of the age." After we walked away from this lady, I wanted to leave immediately. I wanted to take off running and flee from hell. The Lord said,
"It hurts me that the love on many on the earth is now growing cold. Many difficult tribulations are coming to the earth. I will show you someone else who once loved me and served me."
As we approached another location, a man yelled out,
"Lord, my God, I always loved you. I always wanted to do your will, but I was double-minded. I was inconsistent in my walk with you. When I preached your word, you led me. At those times I was obedient to you. Eventually I would always leave you and return to my old ways. I should come back to you. But I just couldn't stand my life. That is why I committed suicide."
That man in hell is a murderer. Being a murderer is not only shooting somebody or having an abortion. Homicide is also the taking of a person's own life. If you commit suicide, you go to hell. It is written, "No murderer shall inherit the kingdom of heaven." He is not in God's presence because he committed suicide. You know what, if you're one of those people that get tired of serving God, you can't continue, you are discouraged. You're tired of serving God. Maybe it's because the world is attractive to you. I tell you to reject the desires of the flesh. Reject them. Walk in the Holy Spirit, God will help you to abide in His will. This is not the pastor's responsibility or anyone other than your own. You must rely on the guidance of the Holy Spirit. After we left that location, I looked and saw something startling. I saw two men fighting in hell. A fist fight in hell. This was my third revelation of hell and I had not seen this yet. There are many churches that are filled with hypocrites. Men who are nice in church but in actuality they fight over anything. They fight for money, they fight for church members, and they continually fight. Hypocrites, the souls belong to Christ. The money isn't for men, it's for working for the kingdom of God. These two men fought angrily. More men came and joined in on the fighting. Demons continued to torture them while they fought. The flames burned them and they were in great torment, they yelled and screamed in agony. I asked the Lord, "Why are they fighting?" The Lord did not answer me. I turned to the men and said, "Stop. Why are you fighting? You are in torment and you continue to fight. Tell me, why are you here? I want to know." A man looked at me and spoke to me.
"We fight because we can't escape this place. We are the same here as we were on earth."
I didn't understand this. "What do you mean? I don't understand. I learned this person's name, but I shouldn't say it." This man explained more to me. He said,
"On earth we fought for profit, we fought to take church members to our own congregations. We fought to have more for ourselves. Now I have repented and I ask God for forgiveness."
The men fought continuously. The Lord told me,
"There are many people on earth who were once faithful servants, but now they are headed towards this place. Tell them not to come here."
This is my responsibility. I have been warning pastors as well. I have gone to places where the focus of the ministry has been to make a profit. There are pastors who fight for money. They also fight to take church members. This is the same reasons those men were fighting in hell. I have also been to places where pastors love God passionately with all their hearts. They would be willing to give their lives for the gospel. But there are also pastors who are hypocrites. Not all of them though. These pastors are vain and so are some evangelists. Some churches do love to work for God's kingdom. It is terrible that some leaders fight to take church members to their own congregations. They want to fill their churches easily. The souls are not ours, they belong to Jesus Christ. There are souls in hell for these reasons. There is no humility in causing rivalry. God does not want us to be divided. He wants all of us to be united. He wants us to help one another. It doesn't matter where you are from. You could come from Italy and you still have the same Holy Spirit. God wants this. God wants us to be one. We are one body and He is the head. We are one body and we must be united. United in love for the work of God. We must also love one another. Unlike those men who ended up in hell. Look how they ended up. Fighting and speaking horrible things to each other. It made me feel bad. After this experience I cried very much. I cried because it hurts my heart to know how many men and women fight for material things. They don't fight for what's really important. Don't fight for material things. We must fight the devil himself so that we don't lose our blessings. Sometimes you have to wrestle for your blessing. Jacob wrestled all night with an angel. Sometimes we must do the same. We must fight to receive our blessing. Don't fight for material things. These things are insignificant. God's blessings are worth fighting for, but fighting and causing division in church is not of God. It hurt me to see eternal result of people who cause division. While I saw these men fight in hell, one of the men who had been fighting had a message to give me. He said, "When you return to the earth, tell people not to fight of cause division. Maybe you are secretly fighting and causing division. Perhaps in public you argue with people. God isn't trying to embarrass you. God is correcting you. He wants you to have a humble and contrite spirit. Repent of your sins and don't repeat your offense. God desires for us to enter His presence, but we must walk in holiness. We must be holy because He is holy." There are so many different things that take place in hell. I did not want to see anything else after seeing those men fighting. I asked the Lord to take me out of there. The Lord began to take me out, but I saw one more thing before I left. Before we left, God showed me people's spirits in hell who are still alive on earth. These people are bound and appear to be in cells. This revelation God gave me is similar to what I heard another servant of God say in their testimony. In hell I saw a young girl that I know here on earth. I saw this young girl in one of those cells. I have not told her yet. The Lord let me know I shouldn't tell her at this time because she wouldn't receive it. I will wait till God's timing to tell her. When the Lord tells me it's time, then I will go speak to her. She is my friend. I wouldn't have known this about her without this revelation. The Lord's revelation to me was that she was in that cell because she was a slave to sin. I said, Lord, I don't understand. I see souls fall into tunnels and land inside of hell, but others simply remain in this place. I would also see double-minded Christians heading to this place. I looked around and saw many people bound by sin. The Lord told me,
the girl you see is living in fornication. She also has resentment in her heart, not my peace. Go and speak to them.
The Lord said them, because there was another girl there that I also know. Two girls were in that place of bondage that I knew. Those girls are bound by sin. The Lord said,
go and tell them that I want to set the captive free and liberate them. I want to liberate them from the prison they are in and do great things in their lives.
I said, yes, Lord, I will tell them. As we continued to walk, I saw many souls in bondage. Unfortunately, they had all known God at one time. We walked up to the other lady that I know. This lady was in the same situation as my friend. She said, Lord, I can't remain here any longer. She was crying. The Lord said,
this is her conscience. She is living in disobedience, in sin.
The Lord revealed more things to me about that woman. The Lord said, go and tell these two women what you have seen. I have already spoken to one, but not to the other. It is not the right time. After I have spoken, it becomes their responsibility to receive it or not. God wants to set the captive free and loose him who is bound. God wants to set you free. God wants to take you out of slavery and bondage. He is able to give you freedom. This is true. Resentment leads to bondage. Hatred, bitterness, and these emotions all lead to that place. You must ask God to search your heart. What is in your heart? Acknowledge that there is sin and ask the Lord to break that yoke of bondage. God will break those chains and release you from that prison. When you acknowledge and repent, the Lord will set you free, but first you must acknowledge sin and repent. The Lord will set you free. You must repent. I said, you must repent. Afterwards, the Lord began taking me up and out of hell. We were climbing a stairway through a dark tunnel. When we arrived at the top, I looked down and saw hell from a different view. Hell is an extremely large place. From my viewpoint, I saw hell in a central profound location, and I also saw the lake of fire. They were separate. The lake of fire was underneath hell. This is the way I would attempt to describe what I saw. I saw a large tub of fire and sulfur. Above this container I saw the shape of an awl, or a body. The tub is the lake of fire. After the Lord showed me the lake of fire, we left. For those of you who are listening to me through a video, allow me to share this with you. God gave you this message because He is real. We don't serve a dead God. We serve a living God. He said to me,
I never change. I continue to be the same living God. I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I am the God of yesterday, today, and forever. I have never changed and never will.
Don't forget, we serve a great God. Seek His presence in spirit and in truth. Don't be hypocrites. Serve Him both in spirit and in truth. May God bless each and every one of you.
Time is running out. God requires for His church to walk in holiness. Every moment counts. Don't be condemned by sin. Now is the time. Accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior and serve Him wholeheartedly. Don't fail to do God's will.
What I have revealed to you, you must speak. It's necessary. It's necessary, so the pastors will return to me. So the pastors won't condemn their congregations, because the churches will be in the condition of their pastors. This is why I allowed this. I will do great things. My daughter, don't fail me. Everything I have revealed to you, you must speak. You must tell the world of everything I have shown you, the whole world, because you will go to nations. You will go to nations preaching of what I have shown you. It's necessary. It is I who speaks, believe my servant. She is the daughter of my eyes. With the humility she has, I will use her. I took her so she could see the message I have for the churches. This message is for pastors. Churches will follow their pastor's example. There are many churches, but few are chosen.
Sister Angelica was shown that 80% of the evangelical Christian church on earth will be left behind. Then are you within the 20% who will get raptured? It is time to repent daily. It is time to forgive others. It is time to turn away from those sins. It is time to surrender all to Jesus. It is time to love Jesus with all your heart.